It's time now to say something of the character of Constable's landscape. His motives are humble. Dedham Vale, Hampstead Heath, Willie Lott's cottage, boat building near Flatford Mill. As C.R. Leslie, his early biographer, writes, he worked within the narrowest limit in which perhaps the studies of an artist ever were confined. But his aim could be best attained by a constant study of the same objects under every change of the seasons and of the times of day. The sky, Constable called, indeed, the keynote of all classes of landscape. Fancy Poussin saying something like that, or Courbet, or Cézanne. And clouds were Constable's delight and obsession. In one of his letters to Leslie, he suddenly breaks off and puts in the exclamation, "I can hardly write for looking at the silvery clouds." On his cloud studies, you find entries such as this. September 5, 1822, 10 o'clock morning, looking southeast, brisk wind at west, very bright and fresh, grey clouds running far over a yellow bed about halfway in the sky. And we have an analysis of a painting by Ruysdael from him, which is a masterpiece of analysis not of composition, but of the weather conditions prevailing at the moment when Ruysdael painted. The adjectives with which Constable describes his own pictures are very telling, too. Silvery, windy, and delicious. All health. Nothing stagnant. That, he said of his painting, a lock. He knew no false modesty about his achievement. He knew that his peculiar, dewy, breezy bloom had never before him been perfected on the canvas of any painter in the world. Fuseli, who belonged to the 18th century and the world of Blake, said of Constable, "He makes me call for my greatcoat and umbrella." But Blake himself, when he saw Constable drawings, said, "Why, this is not drawing, but inspiration." Constable, incidentally, answered, "I meant it for drawing." Even so, however, he did call himself a visionary, in order actually to excuse being irritable with clients and dealers. A visionary, the very word Blake used with so much more justification. I suppose to Constable the word must have had an undertone of vision in the optical sense. It is in any case very remarkable, I think, that the last sentences of the last of a course of lectures he gave at the Royal Institution 9 months before he died, the last sentences are like this. Painting is a science and should be pursued as an inquiry into the laws of nature. Why then may not landscape painting be considered as a branch of natural philosophy, of which pictures are but the experiments? Well, surely there we are back with a bang in our subject of Englishness, the rational approach, even in Constable, where one would least expect it. And the atmospheric approach is just as English. And so is, of course, Constable's primary choice of landscape as his exclusive subject. Just as Hogarth spoke, you remember, of what the puffers in books call the great style of history painting, so Constable, in a letter in 1828, wrote, "I have heard so much of the higher walks of art that I'm quite sick." Hogarth's art, Constable's art, and please note also Reynolds's art. They have indeed this in common, that they are all based on close observation of what is around us, whether the behavior of people or the features of a man or of a sky and trees. That, we have seen, is England's eternal contribution. But we have also seen, apropos Blake, and equally apropos medieval architecture, that England is ill at ease in the world of bodies, self-consciously displaying their fleshly presence. And so, when it came to landscape, in the Romantic Age, it was England that led Europe away from the landscape arranged with carefully disposed masses and towards the atmospheric landscape. that Claude Lorraine in Rome and such Dutchmen as Cuyp had done much the same in the 17th century need not detain us here. The fact remains that Constable's searching naturalism is devoted to air, and that Turner's anti-naturalism carried him away into phantasmagorias of nothing but air. Golden visions, wrote Constable of Turner, but only visions. English landscape painting of between 1800 and 1840 is immensely varied in character and personalities. Blake's few landscapes range from the completely disembodied God moving on the face of the waters to the small, wonderfully compact woodcuts which he did for Thornton's Virgil, and which almost at once released Samuel Palmer's youthful genius and gave us the landscapes of his visionary years, as Geoffrey Grigson has called them. Many years later, Palmer spoke of the raving mad splendor of orange twilight glow in these landscapes of his. And while he painted them, he wrote, "I will, God help me, never be a naturalist by profession." The surface of a Palmer landscape is, to quote him again, all sprinkled and showered with a thousand pretty eyes and buds and blossoms gemmed with dew. Both Henry Moore and John Piper owe much to this exciting dapple. Cotman, with the heavenly peace of his smooth, flatly and coolly colored landscapes, is the very reverse of Palmer. Yet what they have in common is the intensity of feeling for nature, combined with an unreal coherence of the surface, independent of the corporeal shapes, which lie, as it were, behind. A look at any Bonington landscape will show you what draws Cotman and Palmer together. Bonington, on the other hand, belongs to Constable. He has the same bold, open brush strokes as Constable, that sense of breeze and never once arrested change. To explain what distinguishes the two would need more time than I could give to it here. Bonington died as early as 1828. Constable died in 37. With David Cox and with plenty of good minor painters in watercolor, this broad English achievement carried on beyond the middle of the century. I said in watercolor. Incidentally, the watercolor as such is, of course, also an English phenomenon. For one thing, it is small in scale, as are, for instance, the bosses and the capitals and the marginal little people in the Middle Ages, and as are also the wonderful 16th century miniature portraits by Hilliard and Isaac Oliver. But the watercolor as such, as a technical medium, so much thinner and so much less full-bodied than oil, that is English too. Side by side with the pure landscapes, there are such English specialities as the sporting picture. It is characteristic enough that it is a speciality, but how it is handled is equally characteristic. Mr. Basil Taylor has recently written a pelican book on animal painting in England. The title of the book is significant, for it deals little with the popular sporting picture of the alcon and leech kind, which may be skillful reporting or boisterous cartooning, but doesn't reach higher. Where animal painting is at its best, where even the racing picture is at its best, there is no exciting action, but there is a curious stillness. There is no one in England to compare with Rubens in the Netherlands or Delacroix in France, except perhaps James Ward. Stubbs, the greatest animal painter in England, was a scholarly student of anatomy. His compositions are, as Mr. Taylor says, very still, very fastidious. And he went to Italy in 1754 to convince himself, as he says, to convince himself that nature is always superior to art, whether Greek or Roman.